we will start with how you all got to jail. We open up on a bustling marketplace. There are stalls open surrounding actual shop fronts where the shop vendors are selling their wares out to people who are passing by. In the midst of all this bustle and hustle, in an alleyway, kind of adjacent, a slime man hides in the shadows. Please describe your funky little slime man for us.
How would I describe him?
Like, how do you top that description is my question.
Yeah, how do I even go
slime
from there?
Man in the sewer.
Stinky.
He's the color of the deep ocean.
Blue.
I don't know, he's got a sick little bandana around his neck. He's got a cowboy jacket.
A little sexy.
Shirtless, of course.
Obviously. In the sewer?
Oh my god!
Shirtless in the sewer!
Himbo representation?
Sewer himbo.
He's a stinky himbo! He's a slime. Sewer smell doesn't affect him.
The funky little slime man in the sewer, kind of peeking up where one of those little sewer holes are. I want you to roll a perception check for me.
16.
Okay. So you look around the marketplace from your low vantage point, and across the way, you can see a cute little inventor's workshop that has a little storefront in the front. And some of the wares are just laying out, and you've noticed that the vendor has exited into his shop for the moment.
I would like to steal.
Okay. Roll a stealth check for me.
Oh, hell yeah. I'm very good at this. He's very good at this. Oh, no! 11.
He just straight up walks up to it and grabs it.
It just absorbs it into his body.
Through the door.
Like an amoeba.
So you absorb it into your little body?
My funky little jello body.
Yes. Okay. So, you didn't do anything to the adventure beforehand, so when a bubbling starts in your stomach...
Hold on. Oh no.
There's a weird feeling that maybe you should have looked at the object before you put it inside.
Absolutely
you.
Not. It was shiny.
A massive orb envelops your body before suctioning you into the shape of what would be a human person, except because you are a slime, it just keeps going down until you are a little orb of slime.
My muscles! I've
after
been demoted.
After a few moments, the gnomish inventor exits his workshop, and he notices you on the ground, and he notices two little floating eyes, and he's like, okay, I kind of understand what happened here. I'm taking you to the police.
I want to resist. I'm resisting arrest.
Like a hamster in a ball, you start to roll away from this gnomish inventor.
There he goes. He's like, all right, best friends, I'm about to head out.
And then he was never seen again. He does it with both hands.
Okay, roll it.
It hasn't even been 15 minutes and I'm dying.
Damn it, he's so smart. He used both hands. Damn it.
Yeah. Anyone smart knows that you have to hold a separate head with both hands or it'll roll out. When you're taken to the guards, the inventor politely asks that they move you to a different receptacle because his invention is still lodged inside of you. So that whole process, just, they pop the ball that you're in, you immediately fall into a jam jar.
No!
Oh, no! Send his ass to the jar!
To the jar! And
they're putting me naked in the jar? Unfair.
It is like a cartoon! Someone writes in crayon, Elo's jar, just crossed out.
They also slap a little label on it that says criminal on the jar. So next we move to a more refined part of Marble's Cleft. There's rich folk milling around, a couple of people who work for the upper class. There's a small crowd forming around a very, very tiny half-elf who's extremely, extremely loud about opinions that he has in this district. Xanavar, if you could roll a persuasion check for me.
Okay, I hit roll and now I have 14.
Great. So you have a pretty large crowd of people around you. Most of them are people who are just kind of interested in what's happening in terms of like, wow, this is definitely a spectacle on the street. But some people are genuinely listening to what you have to say. What do you say to these people?
There are people in here dying on the streets, and no one is even bothering to help. Everyone is just going about their business as people are dying. As winter approaches, you are all sitting there with your bags and wallets filled with coins and gems and jewels. There are our children dying in that alley just close to us, and people don't understand anything. And he just like that.
So it's been a bit of you going about like this, and if you could roll a perception check for me. Keeps your notice until the last minute, but there is a concerned noblewoman who has approached the guards who were just watching you up until this moment. And she's been talking to them for a couple of minutes, and it doesn't really blip on your radar of things to be concerned about until three guards approach you. And one of them kind of like this just very cautiously goes to reach out for you and is like, sir, you're going to need to come with us.
For being so sexy.
Yes. Arrested for basic advocacy of poor people rights. Basically.
There we go. Here's the fantasy oppression I've been waiting for.
Oh, thank God.
You see, this is why I didn't want... This is why we swore no to the podcast.
Right. He says, excuse me, do you know who my father is? He would get let me do that again. Do you know who my father is? He would agree with everything I am saying, and I have spoken nothing but the truth. And
he waggles.
Ooh, the finger waggle.
Finger waggle. Like, do you know who my father is? I am a very important man, and he would not be very happy if I were to be taken by the guards.
Okay, sir, if that's the case and your father is an important man, then we will send a letter to him, but you do need to come with us, and we're making some of the citizens in this area, nervous.
What? Speaking the truth? What? I have
I love this character. I'm gonna make him. I'm gonna make so much fun of him.
I love him.
Oh no!
Okay. I would like you to roll another persuasion check for me. Just very fast. It's okay. It'll be fine. Oh my god. Hey, great. So the guards, instead of apprehending you as roughly as they would a normal criminal, they kind of just flank you and lead you off in the direction of the guard tower instead of, like, putting manacles on you or anything. It's mostly just like a, like, we need you to move away from this area so people will stop being worried. But also, because you rolled that high on your persuasion check, the people who were with you and, like, listening avidly to what you were saying start to, like, put up a fight. Like, they're not into the fact that you were being taken by the guards. Which, for the sake of going fast on this, it's not great for the general, like, it's, things are on fire, I think. it's just a couple people, but, like, it's enough that the guards need to call in backup to, like, kind of calm everything down in this area.
So they just basically set like a building on fire.
Yeah, arson. Woo! Yeah, so Xanabar is led off to the guards tower where they're like, okay, you incited a riot. We need to detain you. Like, we can still send a message.
Backfire. They're like, oh no, I guess this is like a rebel leader or some shit. Alright, we gotta get you out of here.
I guess this is the start of an insurgency. My boss is gonna be so mad. And then they kind of lead you off to a cell. When you get to your cell, there is a jam jar on the table, looks like, but it's full of, like, not jam.
Don't look
weird.
Inside of it.
It's full of not jam. Yes, not jam.
Okay, and a few hours later, somebody comes into the same district. Large, imposing. There's a bit of destruction everywhere. Most of the people have been herded off, but there's still, like, a heavy guard presence in the area, and a lot of the nobles are feeling extremely paranoid.
As they should.
I'm excited.
Gash, can you please describe your character for us?
Gash is... How tall did I make Gash?
Lord.
This is a very, very important character detail. Hold on, let me fucking check. She's 8'10". That's the first thing you need to know about her.
Yes.
Just kind of, you said, so the city's kind of in destruction right now, right? Like
a little
destruction as a treat. So the first thing the townsfolk see is just, for one, the sun seems to go out for a second, and then they realize it's just the shadow. I don't know how many barbarians there are in this city, but I feel like even they look like they're, like, in an adventuring party or, you know, they're going to the tavern to get, like, a beer or something. She looks like she just rolled straight out of the wilderness. She's, like, wearing an animal pelt. It's, like, spired with something suspiciously dark and red. Her head tilted down low, hair covering her eyes. And she's just moving forward. Oddly enough, she doesn't seem to be that... She doesn't seem to acknowledge the destruction around her at all.
So,
but she isn't contributing.
Perspective.
To it.
This town is mainly populated by dwarves and gnomes.
Yes.
Half off at above 5 feet if they are extremely tall. So it's just all these like 4 foot kings walking around, literally half the size of this furball.
Tall queens surrounded by little manlets.
There are people who are literally running away from her. At some point, one of them runs in the direction of a set of guards. And
also another detail I forgot to mention. She is dragging behind a great club that's almost as big as her.
I said running, they are screaming and running. that's a lot. Faster than Xanabar's, I would say. The reaction time on this is just so high. The guards come towards you, and instead of the 3 guards that Xanabar got, you have about 6 to 7, and they are not nearly as friendly with you. One of them approaches, kind of shaky in his voice, and he's like, "Stop right there! What are you doing in this side of town?"
Gash pauses momentarily, and then continues to attempt walking forward. Are these guards also, like, halflings and gnomes?
Well, some of them are dwarfs. I think there's one gnome, probably. There might be a couple humans in there. None of them are as tall as you.
Yeah, no. She surveys the semicircle of guards around her, finds the shortest one, and just kind of attempts to move, attempts to sever the weakest link and, like, push through.
The gnome literally scrambles through your legs, like terrified scrambles through your legs, and like one of the dwarfs like kind of nudges the gnome, and it's like, "Dude, come on, this is our job." and then kind of like scoots in front of you and like holds his hand out, and it's like, "You're gonna need to come with us."
Another momentary pause. Continues to try moving forward.
Real boss shit.
Wow.
Could you roll an intimidation check for me, please?
Okay. It's an unnatural 20.
Oh my god.
So,
oh my god.
The rest of the guards are fucking terrified of you. The dwarf that you have just insulted is livid.
As long as no one is physically preventing her, like, just physically barricading her, Gash is moving forward. But she...
As you say that, the dwarf tries to make himself, like, what the fuck is it called? A wedge between you and your forward movement. Like, hands on your thighs, like, kind of being pushed back by your strength. Just, you know,
Gash attempts to move him with her foot.
Damn.
He's kind of on a diagonal, so his feet are a little bit too far away for you to kick without it being an awkward movement for both of you.
Okay. What is an equally comedic movement? Gash will try to... Is it possible to try to push him away with her great club?
Yes, absolutely.
Oh no.
She's not rolling attack. She's
the
not
moment she even brushes him with her club, the rest of the guards spring into motion. There is
Gash punches a cop.
Okay, roll.
I can't if you don't.
Okay.
So you absolutely biff it. There is no way that, like, you just go straight over this dwarf's head.
Too short.
You completely miscalculate the amount of distance between your fist and this dwarf's head, especially because he ducks slightly, and he's like, "She assaulted an officer, get her in manacles!" And before you,
Nash
like...
Nash continues to try punching guards.
You resist for a while. It is just a mess of fists and like
it's a cartoon dwarf. It's a cartoon dust ball with fists.
At some point there are dwarves stacked on top of each other, like trying to get on your shoulders. fucking thing.
That's some manless shit.
But they do manage to get manacles on you. And as you walk through the rest of town, people are just gawking at you.
She's still gawking. I didn't even think of that.
Yeah. And, like, as you walk through the streets, there's, like, whispers that pass by all the people on the street that are like, "Oh my god, she fought the guards single-handedly. That's so cool. Oh
my
god.
She didn't even use her hands.
She assaulted the police."
Eventually, they finally get you back to the guard tower. You do have to duck your head at every moment you are in this building. I cannot emphasize how small this is compared to your body.
Gash does bonk her head a bit, like, once or twice.
Yeah, 100%. Eventually they get you in your cell and it is cramped. And you see just this tiny little half-elf in a cell across from you, and again, the same jar of weirdly colored jam. Mm-hmm.
Gash is curious about that jam.
It just looks like weird jam. Maybe tasty? Maybe it's tasty.
Gash sniffs the air.
No.
Does it smell tasty?
It smells like a Bath and Body Works, like, ocean scent.
Gash is pleased.
Great. All right, we cut to a bar that Gash attempted to enter earlier this evening. It's a little later in the day. I would say, like, 10-ish, like, when there's a decent amount of people at the bar, everyone's just kind of drinking off the day's woes. And no one needs to drink off their woes more than Dante. Please describe Dante to us.
Dante is sitting in this bar, and he's just kind of like, it's like he's been there for, like, at least 6 hours, just sitting, drinking, mm-hmm. looking around. He did all his work, like, earlier, and I don't want to say what his work was, but and after a nice long day, he goes and gets fucked up at a bar, and
he looks like a sad dad.
Yes, he looks very, very sad, but also just kind of bored. He looks really bored. He's got whatever the fuck, I don't know, like a, there's a multiple glasses just kind of around, and I think some of the bartenders are a little too afraid to say something about that. Every time they try to suggest that he should stop drinking, he just gives them a look.
Yeah.
Can I fucking help you? leaves it at that.
With drow, but they are odd enough that, like, the fact that you are here and that you're not, like, somewhere more fancy where, like, diplomats usually go is really off-putting to them. So they're like, wow, a drow. Also, this drow is very aggressive. So none of them really want to talk to you. At some point, one of the bartenders kind of approaches you. And she's not into the fact that she has to approach you. You get the impression that it wasn't her idea. Maybe her manager asked her to do this.
No.
I've been at the other side of this. I'm a barista.
She just kind of approaches you and, like, gently puts her hand on the bar in front of you. And, like, between some of your glasses, maybe just kind of, like, collects a few of them and it's like, hey, my boss says we have to start cutting you off. Is that okay, sir? I'm so sorry.
And he, like, it takes him a second to respond because he is just so fucking appalled that anybody would say anything to him at any point in time. And he just stops.
Say things to me?
And he looks up at her. And he just stares. And then he glares.
She flinches. She jumps a little bit back, holding the glasses that she was kind of collecting to her chest. And she's like, I am so sorry, sir.
Oh my god, I'm so sorry. Okay. I don't think he would do anything until she'd, like... If she went to go get somebody else, then he'd care, because right now he's just, he's like straight ignoring her. He's humming to himself. He's humming a song.
She's past the point of, like, being able to talk to you with her mouth words. She goes and gets some assistance. When she talks to her manager, the manager, like, goes to a different table of a couple of dudes who look pretty formidable. Mm-hmm. And he's like, there's an exchanging of money. He politely asks them to come and get you and assist you out of the building, perhaps with force if necessary.
Mm-hmm.
And they do approach you at the thing. Yes, that's what it is called. And the barista is just kind of off in the back room. The boss is standing in the corner watching this all happen, and about four dudes, maybe mercenaries, start approaching you, and they're like, hey, the nice lady asked you to leave.
And he just says, yeah? Okay.
Respect essential workers.
I don't understand. What? He does not understand. He's just
not
kind of like...
respect essential workers?
He just turns around and he's like, he is too far gone. He is too far gone.
Too drunk.
He is too drunk.
One of them, like, grabs the hand that is currently trying to refill his drink, and is like, buddy, we're gonna have a problem if you keep trying to pour drinks.
Oh my god. He casts Ray of Frost.
Oh no.
Directly into his, like, crotch area.
I'm not gonna roll in this today because I imagine having to fight every single person in the bar would be an endeavor that would be exhausting for everyone involved.
But the fact that he's attempting to do this while drunk, no less.
Yes. I would like you to roll...
Ball attack maneuver. I can't believe this.
I would like you to roll a d20 with disadvantage, if you could.
Okay. First one is a 6.
Okay, great.
Second one is a 20.
Okay, great. I'm so glad I asked you to roll this.
Sorry.
That was a nat 20 and a 6, which is phenomenal. I love that for you. In your brain, you can imagine a reality where you, like, manage to, like, get every one of them. It's like a full, like, Sherlock Holmes moment where you're, like, matching.
He really wanted to be so cool in that moment.
It's the drunk dream.
Except you cast Ray of Frost. And it hits the wall, and the dude's like, bro, we've got a magic whip in here! And he just blocks you straight in the fucking face. And I will say that you do manage to put up a pretty decent fight. A lot of these dudes are extremely bloodied by the ordeal. You do manage to, like, get a few of them down, and there's, like, a pile of carnage in the area.
I want him to just be, like, on the floor making, like, snow angels with the blood.
Yeah, he Tony's drunk behind the bar covered in blood. Some of these dudes aren't okay. And, like, I will say it is a bloody, brutal affair. It is not nearly as efficient or pretty as your usual, like, your usual bullshit is.
Yeah, he's just a little drunk. Just a little.
Just a little.
As a treat.
As a treat.
At this moment, the door opens with a little jingle, and somebody enters the tavern. It is a beautiful tiefling, a little red tiefling who's wearing a nice little outfit, big old tail behind, and he looks in here and is immediately horrified. Please describe
the hell did I walk into?
Fuggio. He, you know, he's walking in, you hear the little, like, clicks of his shoes as he walks across the floor, but then it's just, he stops, like, taking a second to realize the carnage in front of him.
What and you see is just bodies. Not all of them are dead. Some of them definitely are, which is a problem. And there's, like, a bunch of workers cowering in the back room that you can just barely see.
Oh my god, he is holding them hostage. Nobody's gonna fucking leave until I get my drink. He's like on top of the counter, like, what's it called? That fucking Ronald McDonald video.
Yes.
He's like pouring alcohol over his head.
Yeah. Dead bodies all over the place.
He's covered in blood and vodka, and it is a sorry sight.
What does Fuggio
do?
Oh my god.
Fuggio, so he is very horrified, but he's dealt with a few crises before in his lifetime, so he's immediately like, fuck, I gotta de-escalate this, I need to help. So he basically, he's kind of just like, you hear him kind of like shouting, like, excuse me. Speaking, sir. You on the counter? Hello?
And Dante does not like. He like notices him out of his peripheral vision. His vision is like swinging. He like turns around and he's like. His eyes are like half lidded. He's just like. Ugh. And then I just want him to puke on the floor. Just a little. maybe he falls down, hits his face, flat down.
Can you roll a constitution saving throw for me?
Yeah. Let's see. Which one is that?
So it's you roll a d20 and then you add your constitution modifier. You're a wizard, so I don't think you have proficiency in it. It's just your constitution modifier.
Okay, so my mod is +2. So let's see. Okay. 7 + 2 = 9.
Okay, so it's not as bad as it could be. But there is a considerable amount of vomit on the floor that is now mixing with the blood and the vodka. It is not a pretty sight. And when you fall over, you do land directly into it, which is not.
Oh no! It's like Rick and Morty, like.
Morty.
Yeah. It's pretty fucking gross.
That's fucked up.
Yeah.
Is he like out, or are you still conscious?
No, I would say you saved from falling completely unconscious, but you are now trying to kind of drunkenly scramble your way out of your own vomit, which is like, bro.
I'm so sorry.
It'd be horrible.
The mental image. I'm apologizing in advance for what I'm about to send.
Here it comes.
His ass out.
His ass.
Oh my fucking god. Yeah, I feel like after that, he doesn't really understand how embarrassing the situation is. He's just like wiping his face with his like fucking like mage sleeve, just like.
You still have that Sherlock Holmes montage going on in your
brain. Yeah, he thinks he's doing a great. He was honestly, he was trying to do like fucking like parkour, like jumping over and shit.
I think you fucking nailed it. Fuggio would like walk over to Dante's like collapsed body, and he'd probably start to be like, I need to get this guy out of here. So he starts to kind of like lift him up from behind, holding like his arms behind him essentially. and trying to like drag him out.
All right. Oh my god. Do you resist this at all, or?
Let's see. I feel like he's like right now he's in another dimension. He's just got a fucking concussion.
Valid.
He's drunk, so... but also he's like he's feeling somebody grab onto him, and he's just kind of like he's just confused.
Okay.
I want him to use another spell, but I don't know if it'll work. It might end badly.
What is the spell you want?
Well, he doesn't. Magic missile.
Oh no.
And this is not in his direction. It is like where he believes these people are coming from, which there is absolutely nobody. He just sees multiple of Fugio that are around.
He normally magic missile doesn't require you to roll, but because of the situation and your current state. I absolutely want you to roll this with disadvantage.
I just want him to fuck this place up. That's literally it. Okay, so the first one is 11.
Mm-hmm.
And the second one is 16.
Okay. So you hit real good. You hit everywhere extremely good. You do not hit Fugio whatsoever. There is a hole in the side of the tavern that you are now in.
Oh no!
And
oh,
through the hole, you can see the guards.
Oh shit!
Fugio, you notice that by helping out this poor elderly citizen from his drunken, bloody state, you are now yourself covered in blood and vodka. And a little bit of puke, which isn't great. And the guards notice you trying to help this man. And one of the patrons who had managed to sneak out when you came in, kind of updating them on the situation, pointing at Dante. Mm-hmm. And they look at you. They look at you, Fugio, and they notice you helping him.
Oh, fuck.
And before either of you can really think about it, we're both in manacles being led back to the guard tower.
And at that point, Dante is, he's gone. He does not remember any of this at all.
Oh no.
It's a blur. He wakes up, it was all a dream.
What's really upsetting me is Fugio really thinks this man was an elderly citizen.
Yeah. Oh no.
This poor old man.
The three of you that are already in the jail, just kind of sitting here, just, I don't imagine any of you are really talking. Xanavar is still very, very pressed about the fact that he got arrested for speaking the truth. Elo's in a jam jar. I don't know if that's great for his self-confidence.
jam jar. Oh my god, he's so upset.
And Gash just doesn't talk in general, so it's like a very quiet, stoic room. When you finally see these, like, you, most of you have smelt blood before in your lives, and it's pungent, along with the smell of vodka and a little bit of vomit.
And a little bit of puke.
To be introducing into this very small room.
I would like Elo to shake in his little jam jar.
Moves away best she can in her space.
Oh my god.
All right. And this is the room you guys find yourselves in.
Wow.
So, you guys spend the night. All of your equipment has been taken by the guards. Anything that you could use to cast spells, anything you could do to do a hit, anything like that. But you all spend the night in the jail cell next to each other. Is there anything you guys want to do during the evening?
Fugio, the entire time, he's like glaring at Dante. He's not going to say anything, but he's just like, I hate this person. He is fuming.
Dante is like unconscious. He is face down, ass up. You hear him like mumbling, maybe a little bit of gurgling. You might hear a few cuss words while he's like unconscious. I think it takes him a couple of hours to actually, like, wake up.
Yeah.
Gash is just trying to find, like, the best corner of herself to, like, kind of push her whole mess, like, into, which is not a lot. It's not a lot.
It's extremely
small.
And in between, like, she just kind of attempts to, like, she doesn't say anything to any of you. She just kind of puts her, like, hands up against the bars and kind of starts testing them.
Elo's gonna try and, like, push himself with the jar off the table.
Okay. Gosh, I would like you to roll a, an athletics check for me, and Elo, if you could... this would also be athletics, I guess.
Oh, shit! I'm not good at athletics. Five.
Okay. The physics of trying to move a jar off the table while you were in that jar and also weighed down by a very heavy rock, just, it's not in the cards. That's just not, it's not gonna work out.
Man, you these cards are homophobic.
Gosh, I'm so sorry.
An 18. Okay, you pull on the bars, and while it is astonishing that you managed to move them at all, there is a slight bend, but this is dwarven steel? It's not coming undone.
Okay.
Damn. The evening passes. It's pretty uneventful for the most part. Eventually, Dante does wake up, and the guards
bring you. You fuckers. That'll ruin like your whole day.
I'd like to have my phone call, please.
The guards do eventually come in and bring around breakfast. They're not sure what Elo eats, or how they're supposed to feed him.
Did he drop it into the jar like fish food?
Yeah, I think they're just kind of.
Oh my god! They just sprinkle it.
Oh, they better be fucking careful.
He bites them.
Yeah, you will get breakfast. It's serviceable, not great. You can eat it, it's not gross. But it's not a fun meal by any means.
This is something small I forgot to bring up. Fujio is a vegetarian.
Okay, it's bread and water. It'll be fine.
You'll live. You'll fucking starve, vegan ass. Here's also a fun note. Dante hates vegetarians. He thinks they're stupid.
Oh, excellent.
Wow, God, this is so funny. This is how the old man you rescued treats you, Fujio.
Is old.
One of the guards approaches Xanavar and is like, we sent that letter to your father. It should get to, where did you say that you were from again?
The land of the Leonin. And Xanavar looks offended, and he looks as if he should not be in here at all. He is still very pissed off that they even thought to arrest him. And he has no sympathy for the guard in front of him.
So the guard is like, right, land of the Leonin, that should get back to us, like, in a month, maybe? That's pretty far away, dude. But we'll get back to you.
Are you serious? You're just going to leave me in here? I am a nobleman who only spoke the truth about the people who have less privilege than you, good sir.
He just starts walking away, like,
he has no time for this.
The entire time Gash has not been, like, sleeping or eating, she's just been, like, silently, like, still, like, trying to work the bar, the jail bars open. I don't want to roll, like, a strength check or anything, she's just been doing that.
Elo is also still attempting to get as far off the table as possible.
Oh my god, get him out of there!
Ratatouille!
You are extremely hard-pressed. The fact that you demanded to have your scarf put around your jar is making it more difficult to move it.
Damn it, my hubris! No.
It's another half a day before anything really big happens. And it's quiet in these cells, there's no windows. The guards don't really come in, they just check on you through the little window in the door. But eventually, the door opens. And someone doesn't come in as soon as the door opens. There's a bit of delay as this man walks in, kind of adjusting his pants, kind of smoothing out his hair from like a previously ruffled state. And you can see the guard behind him is like similarly disheveled.
And he comes in, and he just kind of waves his hand for the door to close, and he sits down on the edge of the table, right next to Elo.
Uh-oh.
He's like, he's just sitting on the edge of it, just casually, and he's like, "Hello. I imagine none of you want to be here."
Dante's just, he's up, and he's like trying to figure out how to break out, because he's got lockpicking tools. I feel like he just got caught in the act.
I was imagining Dante just being like, "Oh, I belong here."
He's like, "I do."
Elo just casually pleading the fifth. Like,
"I belong here. I murdered 37 people."
Respect minimum wage workers, sir.
Oh my god, this is like the first like. That's it. This is what it's gonna be for the rest of the time.
Yeah, so just looking around at all of you, he's like, "You've only been here for what, an evening? How long do you anticipate being here?"
Somebody answer first.
Elo doesn't talk to strangers. Rule 62.
Very calm. He's just like, "This is all a mistake. I need to be out of here soon. I have things I need to do." "I imagine you do. I imagine you're all very incredibly busy people. Would you like assistance?"
Xanavar immediately speaks up, reaching his hand out of the bars as far as he possibly can, trying to get the man's attention, saying very loudly, I would love some assistance here."
He's tall. Not super tall, but he's a drow man, so he's pretty considerably tall. His hair is like slicked back. He's wearing these tiny little sunglasses that I imagine do more when he's outside in the actual sunlight. He's wearing this fluffy ass fur coat. Underneath it, he's got an open silk shirt, but underneath the opening, he's wearing leather armor. And he just kind of crosses his legs, looks over his shoulder at Xanavar, and drops his sunglasses below his eye line. Mm. He's like,
"Wow, oh my god.
Can I help you?"
Is he, you know,
liberist?
There's no way this man isn't gay.
Oh my god.
Okay, so he looks over at Xanavar, and he's like, "Can I help you?"
"Absolutely can. I must not be here any longer."
Elo's gonna think about it for a minute, and just... "What kind of assistance?"
"I propose a deal. In exchange for your freedom, I have enough money to pay each and every one of your bail, which is not inconsiderable, considering some of you slaughtered 17 people!"
Elo doesn't do that!
Behind him at the jam jar, he's like, "I didn't notice you were, okay, great." And he just kind of picks up the jar and holds it in his lap with a hand on the lid, like, just kind of casually holding it in his lap. Gently taps the lid. He's like...
Elo's gonna push on the top of the lid, just like, like, pushing his way out. "I would like to be in his lap for real!"
I imagine some of you aren't going to be getting out of here for quite a long time unless you get this kind of assistance, and I am in need of help, which I'm graciously offering to give mine in exchange for some in return."
Okay. I feel like at this point Dante's suddenly interested, and he kind of like, he finally gets up from like ignoring this dude, and he walks over to the bars, and he kind of like slides his head in between. He's grabbing onto the sides of it, and he's like, "Is there money involved?"
It's nothing bars.
Elo just like thinks for a second, just like, "One coin to break glass seems fair."
Gash is still pulling at the bars. It is undeterminable if she's ignoring him or not.
There is a future opportunity for cash if you help me this time. I am seeking to employ people, and I'm gonna put it out here. The things that I want help with aren't exactly legal, so the best way to find people for help are people such as yourselves. I'm willing to pay your bail in exchange for this probationary period of assisting me this one time, and in the future, I will pay you for those jobs. I just, you know,
I'm already
so an
IOU, quite a lot of
basically.
Out of here.
And Dante, I feel like Dante does shit like this for a living, anyways. He's kind of like a hitman, you know? Does shit for people that they don't want to do.
I couldn't fucking tell.
Yeah. I figured y'all probably didn't know. And he just flat out was just like, okay, I'm in, whatever.
Wonderful. Anyone else?
And kill more
anyone
things.
Else want out of jail and employment?
Elo, like money. Agreed.
He's so cute.
Yeah, the jar again, and it's like, oh, you're going to be so helpful. So I've got two takers. There's three more in the room. Anyone else?
Well, it's from Gash, but she stops pulling at the bars. That's she kind something. Of turns towards him.
He takes a look at her again over his sunglasses, like,
She just looks back.
She's looking directly at him.
She's staring directly at him, but, hard to tell where she's looking most of the time.
He sets down the jar of Elo, and he walks towards herself, just, again, along the side of the table. He just kind of looks at her, and he's like, so? Can I count you in? You seem like you'd be quite the help.
God, the gay energy that he radiates is intense.
He's so sexy, it's actually unreal. Start
that
slur here.
Considering being homophobic because of this.
Yeah!
Gash kind of makes like a sound like. And sort of leans forward in herself. She doesn't seem impressed by. By the gay necessarily, but she seems interested.
Okay. He smiles, he like brightens up at the fact that she's shown interest, and then he walks around the table again, just like skimming a hand along the surface as he makes his round over to Xanavar, and he's like, and you?
Xanavar lets out a giant sigh, but he seems somewhat relieved. He nods and gestures to all of the men and the big lurking beast lady in the cell across from him and speaks up. Well, I assume if all of you fine gentlemen and lady are in on this quest, I'll gladly participate with you.
Gash,
well,
the bars one more time.
He just like looks over his shoulder and he's like, you keep working on that. I'm sure you'll get out eventually.
She rolled a 19.
And Dante's like, no, let her continue.
With a 19, one of the bars kind of shifts a little bit in its place, but it is still, like, in its lodging.
Gash lets out an unimpressed huff and kind of looks back over to him. Let's go with the bars.
So he, like, turns back to Xanavar and kind of with, like, a hand on one of the bars is like, you seem like you're quite the eloquent one. It'll be a great help to have you on the journey.
Before he leaves, Elo, like, puts his face up to, like, the edge of the jar to him and just goes like, Elo thinks he smells like money.
I love Elo so much.
I feel like Dante is very entertained by Elo. I think the whole time he's just watching their interaction, he's like, yeah, this is good. This is the good.
This
shit.
Is a guy who gets it.
This is a guy who gets it, and he kind of like nods, like, "Yeah, I could smell it too."
It's the criminal background.
No, it's because he smells his fancy perfume, and he's like, "Yeah, he's got money."
Yeah, you fucking kill people.
The man like looks down at you in the jar, and he's like, "I adore you. Tiny thing." He picks up the jar and carries it with him as he walks over to Fugio's cell.
Elo's just like, Elo is not tiny.
In the jar, he says.
Compressed. I am compressed.
So he approaches Fugio and he's like, you're the only one who hasn't said yes.
Well, obviously you just said what you do is shady and illegal. Do you think I want to agree to that?
Dante
oh,
says
the
yes, very,
outrage.
Very
I
much in the background.
Elo thinks you should say yes.
Dante's like, say yes, pussy!
Xanavar speaks
he,
up.
He, like, pulls at the bars again, not really in a we're breaking out kind of way, but you're in a jail cell kind of way.
I am also not a fan of this shady little ordeal, but I think it is better than sitting here for God knows how long.
Xanavar's only saying this because he's gay. That's it. Just be real here.
Oh my God.
So the man, like, kind of lounging against the bars is like, so, you could sit here in your moral outrage, or you could join the rest of us in freedom. Maybe you'll get your hands a little dirty, but I suspect you haven't really done that before. So, new experiences and all that, hmm? Yes.
Dante says,
he got them dirty last night, actually.
Fujio is just like, he's just trying so hard to ignore Dante. He's just like... But
the one hand, like the parasite hand, I'm looking away.
Yeah.
I'm looking away from him.
So after hearing what like Xanavar said, he's considering it, and he basically says, "Okay, I will agree to it, but if things get out of hand, I will do something about it."
I anticipate you will. That's kind of why I'm hiring you. Just stand around and do nothing for this job. I mean, I have people for that, and I don't need you for it. So, everyone agrees? Everyone's good?
I think there's like a general, like, mm-hmm, yeah, mm-hmm, like just.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Great, I will be right back. And the man exits the room for a few minutes. After a few more minutes, the man comes back to the room, he claps his hands together, and he's like, well, that's all done. And one of the guards kind of like follows him into the room and like slowly starts unlocking all of your cells.
Oh no. SCP breakout.
The man like opens the jar personally because he's like, I like this tiny, this
yes!
thing is so good.
Elo absolutely bursts out like.
Oh my God, the man is released.
Tiny no more.
He like grabs the bandana and just like like thins his waist enough that he can tie it around it.
Oh my God!
Oh my God! But his ass is still out.
Snatch!
Where's the
corset? The man is just clapping.
And then Elo like. Elo, like, moves a bit of goop from, like, his mouth onto his hand like he's spitting on it. And he, like, puts his hand out and he's like, rule number 18, whenever making a deal, you always shake on it. And he just puts his hand out.
Fucking God, yes.
Okay, great. Where were we? Oh, yeah, Elo, is snatched. Great. Love that.
He's taken.
Everybody is slowly let out, and then eventually all of you file out of
is he gonna
room.
Not shake his is he not gonna shake Elo's hand?
I fucking forgot about the handshake. He absolutely shakes his hand.
Yes! Elo is jubilated.
Yeah, and it's not even like with like a hint of like, oh, this is weird. Like he fully is like, yes, this is how you complete deals. Like, yeah, no, I'm so glad you have the respectfulness to understand how this works.
Excellent. Wonderful. Elo is very excited.
As they leave, with kind of like the guard walking behind them, because it's still like, you guys are still criminals, and I can't believe you guys just left. Just kind of like...
Criminals, you can leave, I guess.
Dante's like really smug about it.
He can stare at Elo's ass. It's okay, we know the real truth.
Yeah, all of you are given back your positions when they get back to what the fuck is it called, when people's stuff is in a room and they have it, and it's illegal stuff. Locker.
Contraband?
Yeah, contraband, the evidence locker, all that shit where it's like, that's the room where it is in.
The
they
lost
back
found.
All the stuff.
They just put shit there.
We've taken down another floor. And on this floor, it's kind of like a little waiting area, and at the very end, there is a doorway, which he leads you through. It's not the bottom floor yet, though. And when the guard opens the door, it opens to... I have a little thing about this. Okay.
Oh, I can't wait.
He opens the door, and you see an elevator shaft.
The first thing that hits you is the wind. It's a cold day and the elevator is open to the elements. The only thing corralling all of you inside is the protective gates on the outside of the elevator, and while you are all only two stories up, the building has been built on the side of a massive chasm. You all set foot on the industrial-sized lift. Some of you notice the mechanisms only allow for two destinations, here and into the depths of the fissure below. The elevator lurches into its descent only moments later, and before any of you can decide to look back. Moving down, it becomes easier to take it all in. Staring across, the chasm looks to span the size of the city behind you three times over. The landscape on the other side is barren compared to the forest that surrounds Marvel's Flat. In the distance, closer to the fancier side of Marvel's Flat, you see the start of some construction to build a bridge across the divide, faded back against the slick gray rock. Below you, you can see the mining operation that Marvel's Flat prides itself on. The mine is separated by rocky platforms and a complex Minecraft trip. Minecraft.
Minecraft real. Oh my god, is Steve a character?
Hero Brian.
You're in my room.
I can't believe he's taking us to meet Enderman.
Alright, alright. What
the? A complex minecart track, with walkways carved into the stone around them. Another series of elevators move a ways away, with small clusters of buildings and rail tracks connecting the elevators to the main mining facilities. Further along on either side of these cliffs are smaller settlements. Among these structures are a mix of dwarven and gnomish miners, with the occasional Roth and Fomorian hauling larger stones and minerals. Below all of this is a river that roars and twists through the crevasse, a violent warning against approaching the cavern platform's edge. After a few minutes of this brisk drop, you land on the main rock platform and step off of the open elevator. Hallis steps off first, and the guard stays back on the elevator with a little flick of his little gay wrist. He, like, motions you to follow him. And all of you kind of, like, walk through this mining settlement. Miners look at you, and they think, like, it's obvious that they think your whole party looks fucking batshit. but most of them politely turn their eyes down, mostly because if they're rude, they imagine that, especially Gash will beat the shit out of them. I am looking away disrespectfully. and eventually, Hallis walks them over to an elaborate gate that has been carved into the cliffside, with a staircase leading to it. At the top, the gate reveals a path that only leads into the dark. And from here, it's like, there's a little sign next to the gate that looks like it has been tacked on, like it wasn't originally there, that says, to Eolinora. And Hallis kind of like gestures down the tunnel and is like, all right, so you will be getting some people back for me.
Like a rescue mission?
Do you... alive? Yes, like question mark?
Well, I don't know. When they called me, they were... it's been a couple of hours since then. This is kind of a rush job, and I don't want to risk any more of my men going down there, so if you prove to be good at your job and come back and, you know, bring me back my men, more jobs for you. If not, then I'll know they're dead, won't I?
Okay, so search and rescue, I guess.
I think Fujio feels a bit better about this. He's just like, oh, we're saving people. Like, in his mind, he's thinking, there's nothing that shady about this.
And I feel like because of that, Dante's very visually like,
Elo has question.
What's the question?
Do we have to bring them back alive?
I would prefer if you did. They're very helpful.
Yeah. Okay. He looks a little disappointed.
Yeah.
For a second, the guy is like, is this the one that killed 17? Oh, never mind. So Hallis pulls out a map and offers it to whoever is closest to him. You guys can decide which one.
I'll take it.
Great. So he hands it off to you, and he's like, on that map, and when you open the map, there's a big crude red circle over a diverging path from the main road. And it's like, we have discovered that they are around this area due to a tracking spell that I put on all of my people's equipment. And they should be in this area. If they're not there, that's probably an issue, isn't it? But if you look around that area, they should be there. It should only take you a couple of hours to get down there successfully. They were pretty close to the surface when they made their distress call. And then along the sides, you notice there are, like, little crude drawings of bats, and he, like, points at them. And, like, the same red ink that he used to circle where the people are. He points to them, and he's like, that's for decoration. I did those myself. And he just kind of, like, rolls the map back up and, like, hands it to you, like, officially.
Very lovely.
I need to ask, what is the level of quality of these bat drawings?
They're pretty crude, but, like, you can tell it's a bat. Like, that is a bat.
Hey.
It's not photorealistic, but it's like, this person clearly does shitty doodles whenever he's bored, you know? That kind of thing.
I'm charmed.
And then, do any of you, are all of you dark vision? Every one of you? You're all good down there?
Let me check my dark
vision. Probably
yes.
Not.
His
dark vision's failing.
Elo can see very well in dark.
Glasses.
I need my dark vision glasses, hold on.
Gash doesn't have dark vision. He's got a club
set. Elo will pull up Gash's like, hand.
Oh,
Gash kind of like tilts her head to look down at him and compares the size of her hand to like his body.
Elo like looks at the difference and just like moves enough slime to make his hand like really big.
So he opens up his fur coat and he offers out a glowstone torch to Gash. It's like a regular torch, except it's got like this blue crystal on top of it. And he's like, you don't need to light this on fire and it won't go out in water, so it's helpful.
Gash takes it.
Does anyone need anything else? Rations? A hug? Does anyone want a hug before we go?
Elo would like a hug.
I would gladly join you.
Oh no!
So Alice like looks over the group and is like, "All right, everyone, good to go. Any questions?"
Hang on a minute. What is that? Happily is down there. I know there is bats, but how big would they be? I do not want to get all mucky again when I just had my clothes washed.
Mucky.
I am so excited for you to see that there is so much more down there than just bats. All of you, have a good one. He just kind of like walks off.
It would be really nice if he actually like paid us a front.
Wait, do our characters know each other's names yet?
No, none of you.
I'm sure
they all know
Elo's by now.
We know Elo's. I don't think any of you talk to Gash, so you don't. Like,
Dante has mostly
know.
Just been ignoring most of this conversation. Like, whenever he asked a question, he would just, like, be looking away.
Like, don't look at it. I won't turn gay.
That's exactly how I'm saying.
I'm not saying, like, before they go down, Fujio's, like, gonna address everybody. He's just like, alright, well, we need to work together on this. I don't think we've introduced ourselves. I'm Fujio. And you all?
Elo doesn't think he needs to tell you his name. It's a secret.
Thank you, Elo.
I am
Zenobon.
It's a wonderful pleasure to meet you.
Fujio's liking Xanobar. He thinks he's nice. So now Fujio's kind of looking over at like Dante and Gash, like being like, just giving an expression like, are you going to introduce yourself? Or...
Dante was like staring at him the entire time in like contempt.
Gash is looking away. She's looking at the mine shaft. She wanted to start going, but now apparently everyone's decided to stay here for some reason.
Yeah. He's like, can we just fucking move on, please?
I don't know. Like, so long as you're not calling on her directly, she doesn't seem to want to say much, you know?
All right. So Fujio's just like, okay, that's fine. I'll work with two names. And just sides to
two.
He really is trying, and I love that about him.
Everybody who hugged the man, and also Dante, I want you to roll a perception check for me.
Oh, he's got really good perception. Hold on.
God damn it, he stole something from me.
Give me a sec. So, D20.
14.
Great. Everybody else?
Wait, you said a D20 and then what?
And then your wisdom plus your proficiency if you are proficient.
Okay, so wisdom is 3, proficiency is 2, so it's going to be 5. First roll is 21.
Three people who got the hug, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Did you hear me?
Yes, sorry. I got you. 21.
I said, yeah, 21 was mine.
Dante, how come you're so smart?
It's the homicide.
I read a lot of books about murder and killing. It's a very hungry caterpillar.
Did anyone give the guy a hug? Because I got two people.
Give him a little slurp.
I feel like if anybody insisted Dante would hug him, you'd just be like, fuck you. Absolutely not.
Yeah. Yeah, Fuchio didn't want to hug either. He still doesn't really trust that guy.
Gash has Gash two full hands. Didn't. She can't hug anyone.
Xanabar?
Oh, yes, I did hug the man.
Okay, what was your perception check?
Hang on.
Yep.
7.
Great.
Okay.
All of you passed. So Dante has a little pair of sunglasses in his pocket. Just drow to drow, he was like, you don't have sunglasses, the sun is gonna fuck up your eyes if you don't fucking protect them, you idiot. Just shove them in your pocket while you weren't looking.
He's is very upset about this.
Yes. And then the two of you who got hugs from him, they get, 2 pieces of gold in their pocket.
Ooh.
100%. He is just... It is a full power move. Like, I could take anything off of you anytime
I
want.
Yeah, he's just like,
how
is this possible?
He threw the pair of sunglasses into your
pocket. With such precision, it landed directly inside.
What the hell did we even hug again?
Oh, yeah. He didn't give you his name.
Yeah, I'm like, what is his name? I feel like it's not just me who's wondering this. Big
so you guys come to the
I mean, none of you, we don't even have the names of everyone in the party. Why would we have the names of our boss?
Yeah, exactly.
So, all of you head down into the Underdark. Unlike a mine shaft or, like, kind of like a cave, this has clearly been carved out with the intention of being a path to another place. It's kind of like dwarven craftsmanship, so it's a little bit too fancy inside this cave, but, It's a nice path. It's not very difficult to get down. As you get further down, it does start to peter off in terms of how detailed it is and becomes more serviceable. A little bit away, you start to notice that this is about where the turnoff from the usual path is, where the smugglers would be. And it's just like this alternate crack that is definitely a cave in the side of the wall.
That's cool. Is it just like slowly getting darker and darker?
Yeah, so there's there's a little crack hole in the wall. It goes in a different direction than
Is there lighting or is it just for like, is it dark with the expectation that people down here have dark vision?
There's some lighting on the actual path, but in the hole, there's not.
Hmm. But I mean, even if there's lighting in there, if it's such a big space, it's not going to disperse.
It's kind of like hidden behind one of the pillars that they use for one of the rocky pillars that you use for support. So it's clearly they don't expect people to notice that this is there, but because you have the map, it's there. You see it.
Okay.
Dash sort of looks at you. Sort of looks at all of you because she's the one holding the torch. Can I make a perception check?
Yeah, for sure.
Oh, actually, wait. Can I roll the stealth my way down the tunnel?
You want to roll stealth check?
What mod? Okay, hold on. Perception. Ooh, I've got a lot.
My plus 8.
Are there any? I got a 7.
Mine cards?
Yeah, 7.
Like, go down the vine.
This isn't a mine. It's not some place that like people have gone in and gotten ore out of. This is like a hole in the wall that leads off to other holes further into the cave.
Yeah, 17. So it's a little spooky.
As you enter into the little hole, it's only barely far enough across for people to stand side by side. And as you get further in, it starts to narrow down into like it's like a actual cave. You're going cave diving at the moment. And it's not intended for like people to go through. Like, this is clearly the seediest possible way you could get through this part of the mountain face.
At that point, Gash will probably lead because I honestly don't know if she might be too like wide for people to walk side by side with her at that point. So she rolled a 7 on her perception check. She's not seeing shit.
Right. Can I get an order of, like, how you guys are walking?
go first.
So Gap's first.
I think Ujio I'll would go have right to be... behind Gash, I think.
Ujio would have to be kind of nearby the front with the map.
Okay.
You could be behind.
I feel like Fujio and Ilo are side by side because they're smaller. Obviously, they might just be right behind Gash.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then who is behind them?
I feel like Xanobar and... I don't know where Dante is. I feel like Xanobar would be near the back, but not at the very back.
Did you say Dante was at the very back?
I'm pretty sure Dante is slinking around at the very back.
Dante
so
could
like
be
yawning.
At the very back.
And I feel like Xanobar is not pleased. Because he probably doesn't like the smell.
Of what, Dante?
Xanobar turns to Dante and just says to him, "Sir, I do not know your name currently, but when we get out of here, I am possibly buying you a bath at the local tavern."
I feel like Dante is just a little surprised that he actually would talk to him, considering all the nasty looks he'd been giving him like the entire time that he's been in his view. Field of vision.
Up a lot.
And he just like looks back at him and he's just like,
Crusty?
What?
What? Xanobar probably wouldn't even notice that he's giving him like horrible looks because
God.
He has like negative one intelligence.
The fucking dumbass. Oh my God.
That's great.
How dare you speak to him?
First of all, how dare you not take care of your personal hygiene?
He just kind of grimaces at his, like, accent again.
Ew, why are you British?
I guarantee you that it is quite an important subject. As much as you do not care for it, we will continue this topic another time. And he turns around this gay ass.
He's like, a little harump.
The gay pout.
And like, Dante's like holding his mouth because he wants to say a slur so bad it makes him look stupid.
Xanobar's hair whaps right in Dante's face and he doesn't even realize.
He wants to hurt him so bad, but he's trying to control himself. The murderous tendencies.
He opens the warrior cat's book in his pocket. He's like, "What should I do,
Scourge? What would Fire Star do?"
In his other hand, he's holding the Hungry Caterpillar book.
So, as you guys explore this cave, while you're all having your fucking conversations about bathing and you know, rudeness and shit like that, you come across a slight opening that kind of empties out into a crack in the ground. And I would like all of you to roll perception checks for me.
Which one are rolling dice? I got a 12.
Wait, which one is this? A d20?
It's a d20 plus your modifier.
Ooh, 11.
I got a 20.
Ooh.
Great.
But I'm still doing mine.
Poggers. Is that a natural 20?
No.
No, I got an 18 plus 2 of my perception.
Well, I got a 22.
Whoa.
Oh. Ujio and Dante. You notice the sounds before everybody else does. A slight squeaking in front of you. Followed by, like, a crunching. It's not a fun noise, and it makes you perk up when you hear it, away from all your arguments
you
and whatever
see
their,
like,
kind
shitty
of...
elf ears, like, twitch.
Yeah. Yeah. Both of you kind of perk up and look ahead from where you were kind of distracted before. And Gash kind of, like, blinks off into the darkness. In front of her, and all of you notice a pack of giant rats standing in front of you.
Oh, that can't
oh,
be good.
Shit. All right.
Oh, shit.
Rats.
Great. Can everybody roll initiative for me?
Oh, God. I rolled a 4. Hold on.
2.
Oh, I rolled a 12.
If I keep rolling this badly, Dash is gonna, like, reach her hand out of the video, out of the D&D game and kill me.
Gash is real now.
And then I roll for those bad boys. I'm not gonna give them all their own.
Oh, I had asked
oh
earlier,
my god,
what
they rolled so
to?
Fucking well. That's so bad.
Oh, yay! We're gonna get mauled by rats! They have to get through so many of us to maul Dante. Which
and
means
and he's the one that deserves
for the sake
it the
of
most.
Comedy, yeah. They should specifically avoid everyone else to get to Dante.
And he's like, oh shit, alright.
Lucio, you are first.
Oh, okay. Okay. So I want to move close to that one rat that's like near the top.
Okay. Ooh. So you want to move 40 feet towards the rat?
Okay.
And you want to attack it?
Yeah, with my short sword.
All right, roll to attack.
I got a one.
Okay, nat one, you biff it completely.
Oh, poor guy. I'm so sorry.
Oh, no. You know, Fuchio's not off to a great start.
Fuchio books it 40 feet and then just falls on his face.
Yeah, on his stilts.
Rushes over, thinks it looks insanely cool. The rat kind of like starts nibbling at your shoe. And just completely, you just kind of go straight over its head, not anticipating it whatsoever.
That is so
Do you have
funny.
Any bonus actions that you'd like to take?
I want to not look as sad and pathetic, so I think I might scramble up to do the one key thing I can do.
Yeah, after you take attack action, you can spend one key to make two unarmed strikes. Okay, great.
Okay, so my first roll was a 10. So that was only a 2. God, okay, maybe I need to, like, roll this on, because I'm rolling it in a small box, because I'm in my bed. Maybe I should roll it on my bed.
Probably a table, right? Or on the floor?
Yeah. I guess I could do that. And that one was a 4, so 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So that, a 10 and a 12.
Okay, the 12 hits.
Cool.
That's a 5.
Yeah, because I rolled a 1, so it's 1 plus 4.
So, I think that's Elo next.
And I'm gonna move right next to Fujio, and I'm gonna attack with my dagger.
18?
18? Yep, 18 definitely hits. How much damage do you do?
3 plus 4, 7, and then a d6, 4.
It is dead. The rat is dead. Killed
Yay!
The rat.
Yay! I just come in, like, I kind of, like, I want to, like, sneak along the ground and just, with a dagger, just come up and poof.
You do the worm across the ground.
Basically.
Do you have any bonus actions you want to take?
I'm going to use my cunning action to stealth again. 15 plus 8,
23. Okay, yeah, you are hidden from the rats. You just kind of slime underneath Fujio and use him as a barrier. It is the rat's turn.
We're the
best. So this one is just gonna kind of go up and avenge his brethren. it's gonna try to make an attack on Fujio. That's a 23 to hit. Does it hit? Wait, I can see your AC. It does hit. Sorry. That's not a whole lot.
I got a billion. Does it hit?
You take 4 damage from that rat. Okay.
4 rat on. Damage.
I will say this rat also makes an attack on Fujio. Okay, that definitely does not hit. The rat tries to bite your ankle, but you have learned. Step away from the rat as it tries to bite you. Xanavar, you are next. What do you do?
Alright. I want to roll pretty good near both of the rats, and I want to try to take my flute and sing a song to try to get all the rats to calm down.
Okay, roll animal handling for me.
Xanavar's gonna play a rat song in his flute.
Oh my god, really? You know, Dante is not having this at all. He's just gonna... You'll see.
That was such a Dante response. I loved it.
14.
Ooh, that's pretty good. Some of the rats are, like, attentive. If you continue on this line and no one attacks them, they'll probably listen to you. That's
amazing. I'm careful. That'd be pretty terrible.
I'm word on
Fujio. Okay. 6. Great. So Fujio heals straight up. So Gash is next.
Gash is gonna go up to this one, and just bop it with her club.
Great. Roll an attack.
Ooh. 16 plus 5 is 21.
Ooh, that definitely hits.
7 plus 3 is 10 plus 5 is 15.
Okay, the rat is dead.
Yeah, you fucking squashed it, dude.
Yeah, yeah, he popped it like a bug. Oh,
yeah, I'm pretty sure raging is a bonus action.
Yeah, I can go into a rage, so,
just fucking go crazy, go time, stupid.
So you just, so, who's next to me right now?
Xanavar,
you just see Gash set, just kill the one rat with one blow, and then just kind of, like, lumber over, like, next to you, and you can, because she's right next to you, you can see her, like, raging, like,
oh my God.
Her just starting, just, you see her hackles raise up, and she starts to breathe really heavily.
Oh no.
This is the most horrifying woman he's ever seen.
Yes, her hair finally falls out of her face, and you can see her eyes are red.
Oh my God. I feel like his little brain would explode.
Dante, it is your turn.
Most of his, fucking... What's up?
That is on your off. Dante should have gone before Gash.
Yeah, I was like, didn't I get a 4?
Yeah, you did get a 4. I was gonna... Yeah,
it's okay. We'll do it for the next round.
It's
Dante?
Yeah. It blipped in my mind, but I thought Dante just went and I phased out. Like, I just didn't pay attention.
I'll
put a little pink thing next to them so you know which ones are currently charmed-ish. On the way to being charmed.
Okay.
We're all gonna squish this one charmed rat. I feel bad for it.
Okay, so literally all of the rats that are still alive are within 50 feet.
He knows
that he's got moves that can potentially harm the rest of the party, so I'm trying to be smart.
Oh, he cares about not hurting us.
He doesn't.
He really doesn't. he knows that if they die, he doesn't get money.
He wants another pair of sunglasses.
He really,
I don't want to use the Toll the Dead one. Because like I said, all of these guys are within like that range for him. He doesn't even have to move. So I guess he's going to use Toll the Dead on... Let's go with
Fujio.
Yeah, Fujio. No, I'm just kidding. I'm joking. I want it to be on like what's it called? One of the ones that are charmed. We'll go with the one that's directly in front of Xanavar's face.
So I have to roll against a 15. Coming up. Oh, that might do it. Depends how wise a rat is.
Oh shit.
Turns out, not wise. They fail. The spell will let you know if you add anything.
Okay, it's a 5.
Great. So it takes 5 damage. So, Neb, it's your turn.
Okay. Let's see. I'm gonna go for this one that isn't charmed, that's in front of, the one that's, like, diagonal to me.
Yeah, I see it.
Yeah. Okay. So again, I'm gonna try attacking with the short sword again.
Okay, bolt it.
All right. Okay, so that would be plus 6, that would be 17, and then plus 2, 19.
Yeah, you absolutely hit.
Oh my
God, you're
6.
That is 3 plus 4, so 7.
Okay, great.
Cool.
So 7 damage on that little guy. Not looking too good.
Oh,
first found family member of the campaign. This rat.
it's not our extremely gay benefactor.
No, because he's definitely gonna kill us later.
Oh no!
The rat that just got hit kind of looks up at Fujio like, why would you do this to us?
Oh my God. Fujio's starting to be like, oh my God, what am I doing?
Okay, it's Elo's turn.
I'm just gonna attack the rat that's right in front of me with my sneak attack. Does a 15 hit?
Yes, 15 hits.
Okay. 7 plus 6, 13.
Okay, that rat is dead.
Splattered.
Dead ass rat.
Dead.
It smells like dead rat in here.
And then I'm going to use my cunning action to hide again.
Great. You kind of slide behind Fujio.
You just like squat to the ground like when you're playing a Kirby game and you press down.
Yeah, they just think you're a little puddle.
I'm a dangerous puddle.
Okay. So it's the rat's turn. This one's gonna move forward.
This one got hit, so he's not feeling too kind anymore.
You're welcome.
He's feeling a little toxic right now. This rat is gonna make an attack on Dante. The rat misses.
Dante's just standing there staring at this fucking thing.
The rat beneath Gash is gonna make an attack on Gash. That just hits. That is 5 damage.
5 damage. Okay.
And that is the rat's turn, since all the other rats are charmed. So next is Xanavar's turn. Is Xanavar back?
Is there anything I can do to, like, try to get the rest of the rats to run away? Like, go back! You don't need to fight!
Yeah, before I fucking kill them. You could roll an intimidation check, or, you know, something along those lines. I don't know how effective it will be now that they're all in combat with you.
Alright, animal handling or something. Either that, I might just heal Gash, because maybe Gash just scares the absolute shit out of him, so like, okay, I want to get on this lady's good side, and I don't want her to fucking kill me, so I think I'm going to heal her with, like, a little stuttering healing word or something like that.
So sorry to keep interrupting, I just realized, since I'm in a rage, it says resistance to bludgeoning, piercing, and slashing damage.
Yeah, so you would only take 2 points then, if that's the case.
Okay, I get an itty bitty scratch, and like, they're like, oh god, oh god, oh god, I gotta heal you, I gotta heal the people, oh god, oh.
Alright, so Xanavar, in terms of what you have suggested that you want to do, you can either try and roll another animal handling check to get all the rest of the rats on your side. You can use a cure wounds or a healing word in order to fix up Gash. Or you can give Gash the help action in hopes that Gash will roll an intimidation check on the rats next round.
I think I will give the help option.
Okay. So Gash, you have the help action for your next turn if you decide to do that. What else would you like to do?
I would also like to cure Gash's wounds, because he is very scared of Gash right now, and he wants to get on her good side.
Okay, great. So roll your Heelys. Roll your little Heelys.
Roll your Heelys.
That's pretty clever. I got a 9.
9, great. So Gash is fully up. It's all good. He's Gucci.
Thank you so much. Oh, I'm thinking you, because she won't.
Like, please don't kill me.
Please, ma'am, don't step on me.
I'm just a little guy.
Please, no steppy.
I'm just a twink.
He's just a little guy.
Do you want to move anywhere?
Away from Gash.
Would you like to move any place?
Yes, please. I think that he goes to run and hide behind Dante.
Oh my god, get the fuck away from me! if Xanavar gets, like, too close, like, right behind him, like, grabbing onto his shoulders, I think Dante would just, like, elbow him, like, what the fuck?
1 point of damage. His elbow's bony.
One of the rats that you run past is, charmed by you, so it's not gonna hit you, but the one in front of Dante is fucking pissed, so it is gonna take an attack of opportunity on you.
This is
so they do hit, and you take 5 points of damage.
Oh, so sorry.
Get you down.
Good luck with that one, buddy.
Okay,
that must be a giant ass rat. Good god.
Yeah, they're the size of dogs. Yeah. They're dog size.
Big rat.
Xanavar is just screaming behind Dante.
Dante looks very unimpressed.
Dante's turn.
I guess I'll use something on this thing. Alright, so I used a cantrip earlier. Right. I can use another cantrip?
Yep.
Alright. I want to cast Ray of Frost on it.
Okay, the one that just hit Xanavar?
Yeah, on the one that just hit him.
Alright, so you make an attack.
I have 15.
Yep, that hits. Roll your damage.
And we get an 8.
No motherfucker's dead.
Okay, and Dante has, Grim Harvest. At second level, you gain the ability to reap life energy from creatures you kill with your spells.
So, fun thing about this giant rat is that its rating is lower than any health that you would ever get from it, even if it was half.
Okay, so this would definitely be something that would happen automatically if it's, like, anything stronger than a fucking, like, rat boy.
Yeah, and if you were missing any HP in the first place.
Okay, so it would just literally just automatically, their life energy just gets absorbed. Yeah. Imagine it's like,
it's
a,
like
Dark Souls.
Like the rat soul as it dies.
Like
yeah.
Dark Souls. That's cool.
Yeah.
Cool. So he fucking kills this guy. Not because he likes him or anything, Baka.
Okay, it is Gash's turn.
So, it turns out, Gash is a furball. I don't know if you noticed. she has a feature called Speech of Beast and Leaf, in which she has the ability to communicate in a limited manner with beasts and plants. They can understand the meaning of your words, so you have no special ability to understand them in return. You have an advantage on all charisma checks you make to influence them. So, she's not going to use her... She's going to try for an intimidate check, essentially. Nope. And I guess, well, I don't know. The help would give me advantage, and I don't think I get, like, double advantage, right? Like,
no, but it might help the DC a little bit. So roll with advantage.
Okay, so she's going to slam her club on the ground and just let out a giant roar, essentially, to attempt to scare them off. All
right, roll for intimidate. Okay, let me roll the save against that. One fails, two fail, one definitely fails. That's a nat one with a negative. So all of the rats fail. All of them are terrified by this woman.
So is Xanabar.
Okay, Fujio, it's your turn.
Alrighty. I'll go with that one that's next to Dante, and I'll do another sword attack.
Yeah, so it was just 10, so you didn't hit that round.
Okay. I just fall over.
I laugh.
Oh, me too. Was funny. Did laugh.
Okay, it is Elo's turn.
Okay, I'm going to move around to the other side. And then I'm going to use my sneak attack on this one. The three of us have just ganged up around. 19?
Yep, that hits.
Okay.
Roll your attack.
6 damage?
12. 12 damage total. Six
okay, that
six.
Rat is so dead.
Yay! as previous, I'll use my cunning action to hide, and it's a 15.
Okay, great. Good to know. It is now the rat's turn, as they just now are kind of getting it in their heads that this is a terrifying woman that they want nothing to do with. Both of the rats use their entire action to move as far away from her as possible. So this one runs straight off the cliff.
Oh no!
In its fear, just fucking goes.
It's like the rat that jumps into the fucking fryer at Whataburger.
Oh no.
And then this other rat, seeing that its other path is being blocked by these three who are standing over the corpse of its, I'm going to say brother, his brother is dead. He also follows the other rat into the pit. So, that is the end of combat.
Nice.
All right.
Hey, people listening to this recording, I do really love rats in real life. I promise, I swear to God.
End of combat, what do you guys do?
Elo would like to go over to one of the rats and, like, cut off, like, a couple pieces of meat.
Write down rat meat in your inventory.
Man. Oh, no, it's not going to be there for very long. As soon as he cuts them out, he just sticks them into his, like, chest.
He's hungry.
Really disgusted.
He's hungry.
Dante's doing, like...
I would like you to roll a constitution saving throw for me.
Yay! Oh no. 21.
Yep, you're
fine. Good.
You do this all the time. Actually, like, one of your favorite snacks growing up was, like, dead rat. So you're good.
Yes.
Dead fucking rat.
Like, if you took no damage from the rats, but you took damage from, like, rat chunks, I was gonna be disappointed. Gash cleans the rat gets off her bed. no longer in a rage.
Oh yeah, I'm gonna clean off my dagger by just like Elo just like sticks the dagger in to clean off the blood and just pulls it out.
I want Dante to pick up the dead rat that he fucked up and just stick it inside his bag.
Okay,
what?
Each and every one of us.
Puppy sized dead rat in your inventory.
He's got a magic bag.
Elo's gonna come over and just be like, yes, snacks are important.
And he just looks at him and he's like, yeah, snacks are important.
Yeah, just squishes like under his.
It's like the first voluntary physical contact with any of your characters.
Makes sense, it's with Elo. I'd also like to pat him on his little head.
Don't you think anybody would, right?
Yeah.
Gash kind of looks forward to the mine shaft again, and then looks at, like, she turns to look at Xanavar kind of impassively, because the guy did heal her and then run directly behind Dante.
I feel like Xanavar is no longer scared, but, like, he's just kind of there looking at disgust how everybody in the party is treating the dead rats. That is unsanitary.
It is Dante's fucking business, man.
And he's just silently judging everyone who just doesn't leave the rats on the floor.
Yeah. We're all vibing. You're good.
Yeah, he's got his rat. He's got his rat. He's doing good.
Yes. It's always a disappointment to end a session, but like we gotta stop at some point.
Yeah.
God, the art from today is so good. I'm really not liking the society. The Joker mush.
Society.
Society.
Why is the existence of Dante mush?
Dante mush.